Thank you, Marcy, and I would also like to welcome everyone who's here today for the first in our four-part series. As Marcy mentioned, there will be no slides for today's presentation. We are going to be working from two documents that are shown here on your screen. The first one is the wood frame construction manual, and there's a view-only copy that's free and available from our website that you can get by going to the resources page or to the 2015 WFCM page. So you can follow along there on your screen with an electronic version if you haven't purchased one. This document, along with the commentary that goes with it, and I'll show you that here, is available for purchase. And that either gets you an electronic copy that can be printed or a hard copy that you can use. So that's one of the documents. The main document that we'll be working from today that's shown here on your right is the WFCM workbook. And that document contains the example problem that we'll be going through today. So I'll give you a chance to find those if you haven't already and get those on your screen or in front of you, and that'll while we're doing that, we'll have Marcy come and do our first poll to find out who's in our audience today.
Terrific. All right. So what is your profession? We always start our webinars with that question. So I've got that up and most of you are voting, so perfect. And I usually give you about 30 to 45 seconds and about 80% until about 80% have voted. So right, I'm going to go ahead and close the poll and then we'll share the answers. So we've got about 69% engineers, 19% code officials, 7% other, 4% architects, and 1% builder developer. All right, welcome to all of you.
Great. Yes, welcome. We're glad you're here. And so we'll get started in the workbook first. So if you're following along, we're in the document here again on the right that says workbook. I will scroll through and try and get the pages large enough so that you can see where I am and how to follow along if you're following along either with the hard copy or on your screen. But this example problem is going to help us learn the provisions of the wood frame construction manual. And so we wanted to be as realistic as we could, so we actually grabbed plans for a two-story residence. This structure is actually standing today in Williamsburg, Virginia. This is Colonial Homes Idea House in Williamsburg. And it was built in 1995 and featured in the 1995 issue of Colonial Homes magazine. So we made a few modifications to the floor plan. You'll also notice this one shows a hip roof, but we actually did a gable roof as part of our design because gable roofs are pick up more wind, and so it wouldn't be any fun if it was just a hip roof and didn't take much wind load. So we wanted to load it up. So we took this floor plan and used it to design high wind, seismic, and snow load, for high wind, seismic, and snow loads. Now, we know that all of those loads don't occur necessarily simultaneously on a structure. We actually did find a place up in the Aleutian Islands of Alaska, so if we've got any folks from Alaska joining us, you may have these loads simultaneously, but for most of the rest of the country, we know that that doesn't happen. However, it does give us an opportunity to show the broad range of use of the wood frame construction manual. So the example is primarily done using Chapter 3, which has a prescriptive solution, but that prescriptive solution has an engineered background. So for you engineers who are in the audience today, I don't want you to get the impression that this is just like the International Residential Code, which has, you know, a lot of prescriptive provisions that have just been in practice and sort of the way structures have been built without always having an engineering basis. Most all the components and connections and provisions in the wood frame construction manual have that engineering basis, and we'll get into that in a second as we delve into some of the tables. And I hope you'll see that it does provide a pretty valuable tool for getting through a lot of the ASCE 7 wind and seismic load provisions and gives you a pretty comprehensive solution for low-rise structures. So what else? The next page of the workbook then gives a key and a way to have a little more efficiency in the use of the structure. So jump there in your electronic version, you'll see some color coding yellow, or that first box at the top indicates that this value or whatever solution we came up with may be used for design, but there could be multiple options. So if, for example, we're looking at several different species throughout the document, like southern pine, spruce pine fir, Doug fir, hem fir, we'll probably find solutions for all of those different species that work. And so that may give you some multiple options that all will work. Bold font indicates that that certain value controls in the design. So, for example, if we're looking at rafters and looking at gravity loads and wind loads to check to see which one controls, once we get to a solution, we'll show in bold which one actually controls. Green means the value meets the design criteria. If we're crunching some numbers in shear wall design, for example, and we get to a solution at the end to determine that whether or not we've got enough effective shear wall length, then that'll show up as green and okay. NG in red means that's no good and does not meet the design criteria. So those are some of the things you'll want to be aware of as we work through these examples. The table numbers in this workbook have a W in front of them to distinguish them from the tables in the wood frame construction manual. So when we refer to W4.4, for example, that means that's coming from the workbook. That will distinguish it from a table that would we might reference in the wood frame construction manual, like table 3.15. Some abbreviations that are unique to the WFCM workbook you see here in this bullet list. We won't be looking at many of those today. We'll mention the wind and seismic standard, a document that we develop, another one of our ANSI standards called Special Design Provisions for Wind and Seismic. You often see that abbreviated SDPWS. And so if you see that abbreviation, that's the 2015 version of the standard. That's where we get all the shear wall and diaphragm values that are incorporated into the provisions of the WFCM. So let's keep on going here. Over the next 4 weeks, in this four-week series, we'll be covering the topics that you see here in the table of contents. Today, we'll look at the general information, including the layout of the building and the loads that we're going to be designing for this building, and get a little bit more involved in some of the tables and the commentary, the calculations behind those tables, to give you a sense of what is in the background. Then week two will be roof story design, week three second story design, and week four first story design. So we've got a two-story structure and we've kind of divvied it up this way. Each one of these is being recorded and will be available as part of our self-directed study program, and so we're hoping to have that up tomorrow, but no later than early next week. So if you miss one here in the next month, you can always come back and plug in and get the recorded webinar so that you can stay in sequence. And if you've got colleagues who weren't able to attend this first one and want to catch up the next couple of weeks, you can let them know that this first one will be available as well. At the end of the document, in the appendix, with the document that you've downloaded, are few supplemental worksheets and checklists. And they primarily duplicate what you'll see in the example problem as we work through. And after we developed this a few years back, we got requests for folks saying, hey, these worksheets and checklists are pretty handy. If you could give us some blank ones, that might be a useful tool for us in the design process. So take a look at the appendix at some point, too, and see if those are useful resources for you. So today, again, we're going to be covering general information, and the outline here on page one is what we'll look at in the next 45 minutes or so. We will have time for question and answer at the end, so chat those if you want along the way, and we'll take those questions at the end. Last 10 minutes or maybe hang around 10 minutes after the hour, depending on when we finish up. So we'll talk about the building description. We'll talk about the loads on the building. We'll talk about the applicability limits of the wood frame construction manual. Can you even use the document in the design process? And if you can use the document, can you use the prescriptive limitations? Because the prescriptive limitations are a little tighter than some of the provisions in the engineered section. And I'll point out some of those nuances a little bit later on, but I'll show you where to find those tables, make it easy for you. We'll talk briefly about load path and just what that means and how the checklists then can help you as you're working through the load path of the building. So let's jump in then to the building description. Here's an isometric view of this two-story structure that you saw a second ago. We don't show the overhangs here, but there are overhangs on this building that do affect the wind loads. And then there is also either we're going to assume a slab on grade or a basement underneath. And so in week four, we'll be looking at how we attach this structure to that foundation system. Then the layout itself of the building, and let me zoom in here for the floor plan just to give you a sense of some of the dimensions of this structure. You can see here on the right that we've got a 32-foot roof span. And so just kind of keep these in mind as we work through some of these tables coming up here. It'll be important for you to remember some of these overall dimensions. So a 32-foot roof span is assumed in one direction, and then a 40-foot building dimension along the length of the building is assumed. And so you can see the aspect ratio there in either direction is less than 1.5 to 1, and that will be important too as we talk about some of the loads. So this is the first floor plan, typical layout. You see that we have a set of stairs here in the middle of the structure. And to keep from having a discontinuity here at the front of the building, we've put a plant shelf in that allows us to build some of the diaphragm in here so we don't have a discontinuous diaphragm and a two-story tall wall that then we'd have to design. Now, just so you know, you could do that in the provisions of the wood frame construction manual. Per Chapter 3, your load-bearing walls are limited to 10 feet. However, in Chapter 2, once you get to the engineered provisions, you can go as high as 20 feet for a load-bearing wall. So if that plant shelf weren't there, you could design the structure with provisions from Chapter 3 that work. And then for those elements that don't, you're allowed to actually incorporate engineered provisions. And so just know that option is available again for you engineers here in the audience. We hope this provides some time-saving tools for you, but it still does give you the flexibility for engineering that you need. So let's jump down then to the look at the second floor plan. What you see here that I want to point out is that we've got a bedroom here on the left with a raised or a vaulted ceiling, and it's about one-third of the ridge height from the top plate. Then over here on this other side, right above these bedrooms, we've got a finished attic space. We'll take a look at that here in a second. But again, we're following the stairs all the way up through the structure here. But this vaulted ceiling on the left is going to give us a chance to look at some nuances in the wood frame construction manual too that are pretty helpful for designers. Over here then is just a look at the finished attic space. You see the knee walls there on the edges. You see the opening of the stairway and the dimensions of those stairs. So keep an eye on those stair dimensions. There are some limits on openings and diaphragms that can kick you out or cause you to have to design separate diaphragms. And so just note that, and I'll go ahead and spoiler alert, that these diaphragm openings don't exceed the limitations, but you should be aware of that as you're working on your own designs. So then down here at the bottom, just point out, we've got 9-foot wall heights. We've got a 7 and 12 roof pitch. Just under a 25-foot mean roof height. We've got 2-foot overhangs. We talked about the building length and width. This top plate to ridge height will come into play as we talk about wind loads a little bit later on in the series. And so the assumptions that we make about top plate to ridge height for the tables assume a certain value, and then we have some factors that allow you to adjust if you have different top plate to ridge height assumptions. And so just be aware of that. Over here on the right then are our window and door openings. Those come into play when we're talking about shear wall design, specifically about perforated shear wall design. And so in sections or parts 2 and 3 when we're parts 3 and 4 when we're talking about shear wall design, those will become important. So we're setting the stage here for the other programs that will be coming up, but just want you to be aware of those dimensions on the building. The 2015 WFCM is based on loads, and so now we're in the loads section on page 4 of the workbook. So the 2015 version is based on ASCE 710, minimum design loads for buildings and other structures. Also referenced in the 2015 building codes, the 2015 wood frame construction manuals referenced in both the 2015 IRC and 2015 IBC. If you tuned in last month to our webinar that Lori presented, you know that these provisions can also be used for some non-res applications. And so hope as you're going through here and you're aware, if you have a one-story structure, non-res structure, it doesn't know if it's a house or a restaurant when the wind hits it. And so calculating your wind loads, calculating your seismic loads, even calculating your shear walls can be done for those types of buildings within the limits that the code allows for those non-residential structures. So just be aware that that has some applicability beyond this residential example that we're showing here. But for wind loads that we assume in this example problem, this specific example, we went with 160 mile per hour exposure B wind loads. And that's pretty substantial, we know. Those are going to be way out there in the hurricane regions. But we figure if we could design for that, then if you're in a 130, 140, 150 mile per hour zone, then you'll see that it's doable. Again, this is based on ASCE 710, and IRC 2015. So we'll talk a little bit later about the conversion from those other wind loads from ASCE 705. But if you're seeing 160 here, just know that that's going to map out to something a little bit lower in the older standards based on ASCE 705. So we'll talk about that probably in the Q&A or maybe here if we have time in the main part of the presentation. For seismic, we're going to use the simplified procedure from ASCE 710, section 12.14. Now there is an IRC subcategory that you should be aware of called D sub 1, and so we're assuming a seismic category D sub 1 that is allowed per the IRC, and so you'll see those values tabulated for D sub 0, D sub 1, and D sub 2. In the wood frame construction manual. The commentary is going to give you a little more background on that if you're not familiar with those subcategories from the IRC. We're going to have pretty typical gravity loads, and there's a little asterisk here where we talk about gravity loads. It says that the assumptions are going to vary for wind and seismic design or seismic dead loads. So we tend to be a little more conservative with the dead loads that we assume for seismic loads, and then we're going to assume lower dead loads for wind loads, as you might expect. So that tends to be the way the design approach works for those different types of loads. So while we're showing a typical roof dead load of 10 pounds per square foot, we may bump that up in some of the tables when we're calculating seismic loads. We are going to assume a 30 pound per square foot snow load, ground snow load, and we're going to handle the unbalanced snow loads in the tables as well. Again, a roof ceiling load of 10 pounds per square foot, that might get bumped up for seismic, and the combined roof and ceiling dead load of 20 might be bumped down for wind loads, but again, check the footnotes to the tables when you're looking at those to see exactly what those assumptions are. Let me jump over here to the floor loads, and that's what kind of distinguishes this when we're talking about residential versus non-residential applications. So we're assuming typical 40 pound per square foot floor live loads for first floor and 30 pounds per square foot second floor live loads for bedrooms, 30 for the attic space that we have on that third floor, dead load of 10 pounds per square foot. So the reason that we, when we talk about using this for non-residential, say light commercial applications, is that those are typically going to have much higher floor live loads for multi-story commercial and multifamily buildings. And so just as long as you know going in that we're assuming 40 pound per square foot floor live loads, again, some of the tables allow you to bump those up, especially for seismic design. So you could actually use some of these tables and bump up those loads, but you'll have to use some judgment when you're doing that. But again, if you're looking at single story applications for non-res or the top story of some commercial applications that's constructed of wood, then it's certainly acceptable to use these provisions for those applications. Talk a little bit about the deflection limits per the 2015 IRC, and you see the table here on the right, table R301.7. Some of these deflection limits are new in the 2015 IRC, and so we've accommodated those in the standard in the wood frame construction manual. A lot of that has to do with brittle finishes and like plaster versus flexible finishes like gypsum. I'll just point out one here for the exterior studs with a gypsum interior. The table here, R301.7, shows that for exterior walls with wind loads and a flexible finish, you could actually use H over 120, but there's a footnote there, footnote D, that you need to pay attention to that says that for exterior walls with interior gypsum, then you need to bump that up to H over 180. And so this example that we're looking at has gypsum on the interior, and so we're going to use an H over 180 criteria. And then there's a note here, again, there are comparable deflection limits in the 2015 IBC joist and rafter tables. So again, if you're using this for a non-res application, you need to check those deflection limits and then act accordingly. So that's a little bit about the loads. I'm going to take a look at my notes here and make sure that I'm not missing anything that might show up in a poll question or on the quiz that you'll be looking at, and then we'll jump on into the next section. And before we do that, then let's have Marcy come and kick off another poll question for us.
Sure. All right, so the IRC deflection limit for exterior studs with interior gypsum board finish, H over delta, equals 120, 180, 240, or 360. All right. Give you just a little bit longer to vote. All right, I'm going to go ahead and close the poll. And then, oops, let's see, about 73% said 180, 14% 240, 8% 120, and 4% 360. And, Buddy, the real answer was?
Okay, so we were talking about a gypsum, interior gypsum board finish here just a second ago. Always got to pay attention to the footnotes. So that deflection limit in the IRC for exterior walls with interior gypsum is H over 180. So it looks like about three quarters of you picked that up there on that last page. So that is the correct answer. So let's jump then to the applicability limits here of the wood frame construction manual. And take a look at whether or not, as you're looking at a building for design for high wind or high seismic loads, can I actually use the wood frame construction manual? And so one of the first tables that you'll see, and I'm going to actually jump into the wood frame construction manual here now and get to some of those tables that we're drawing from here. If you have an electronic version or a paper copy of the wood frame construction manual, we're on page 2 of that document. Now I can zoom in here just a little bit further and kind of blow that up for you. And so we're looking at table 1 here, the applicability limitations. And so this table on page 2 gives you a good sense of the scope and outline of this document. And so here you can see that we limit buildings to 33-foot mean roof height, three stories, and then an 80-foot building length and width. And then we show the reference section for each one of those where those provisions, where you can get that chapter and verse from the wood frame construction manual. So that'll give you a sense of where to actually look in the text. But I want you to also notice here the load types, the load assumptions below, including the partition dead loads, wall assembly dead loads, the floor dead loads we talked to about 10 to 20 pounds per square foot, the floor loads 30 to 40 pounds per square foot. The wind loads go from 110 to 195 mile per hour wind speeds. Again, these are the ASCE 7-10 wind speeds. And if you remember from the last webinar that we did, we talked about where the wood frame construction manual, or I'm sorry, the International Residential Code, the 2015 IRC, at some point around 130 miles per hour is going to kick you out of the IRC prescriptive provisions into a document such as the wood frame construction manual. So we're at 160. Obviously, that's well above that threshold, and so we're going to use the wood frame construction manual for that. But just know that even though you do have prescriptive provisions in the IRC for wind speeds less than 130, we also incorporate those here in the wood frame construction manual down to 110 miles per hour. And so this tool can be used certainly as an alternate to the IRC regardless of whether you've kicked over that 130 mile per hour threshold. And then you see the seismic design categories SDC, A through D2. And again, that also gives you a sense of where the document could be used for non-residential applications if you are within some of these assumptions, especially the loading assumptions that are shown here for your gravity load situations. So our design case, back to the workbook, back on page 5 of the workbook, our design case has a just under a 25 foot mean roof height, so that's less than 33 feet, we're good. We're kind of actually between a 2- and 3-story building because we've got that attic space, so we'll talk about that next week when we talk about roof story design, but either way, we're still within the limits of that 3-story application, and then our largest building dimension is 40 feet, also well within the 80-foot limits there. So that'll give you a sense of what we got, what the limits are, and whether we can use the wood frame construction manual. And for our design example, we certainly can. So as we jump then to the next page, I'm going to ask Marcy to come back. We got another poll, that one pretty quickly right after the other one. So, Marcy?
Absolutely. Okay, here we go. All right, so WFCM limits the maximum number of stories, mean roof height, and building dimensions to the following. So, 2 stories, 25 feet and 50 feet. 3 stories, 25 feet and 80 feet. 3 stories, 33 feet and 80 feet. 3 stories, 24.7 feet and 40 feet. All right, we've got about 75% voted. Give me about 10 more seconds. All right, and then, all right, so 82% said 3 stories, 33 feet and 80 feet, and then just a smattering in the other choices. So I'm going to hopefully that everybody got that right. So, Buddy?
Yes, they did. The majority did. And back on page 5 of your workbook or in table 1 of the wood frame construction manual, you see those limitations shown here, 33-foot mean roof height, 3 stories, and 80-foot building dimension. So very good. Glad to see you folks engaged and tuned in there. We'll move on then to the prescriptive design limitations. And so this table on page 6 of your workbook is going to be one of the first tables you see in Chapter 3 of the Wood Frame Construction Manual. Let me just get there real quick. And then you can see it in both locations. So Table 3 on page 114 of the Wood Frame Construction Manual shows the limitations and then the reference sections where you can find text to sort of support those provisions. And so in our workbook, we've duplicated this to a certain extent. And again, what we're showing here is, I know that my building is three stories and I'm within the load parameters that you talked about. I'm within 80 feet. But now let's look at some of my joist spans, my joist spacings, wall heights, and spacing of the studs. There could be other things here that could kick me out of the wood frame construction manual. For example, for those of you who are involved in post frame buildings, a lot of times the trusses or rafters are going to be spaced at four feet on center. Well, that pretty much kicks you out of the applicability limits of this document. And so that's, again, part of the checklist, part of what you want to look at to see if you're within the limits that allow you to use the document. So you see here in this table in the workbook on page 6, the limitation shown from the wood frame construction manual limit, and then our design case. And we just put a check mark over there on the right to say, okay, we're good. So we've got a 26-foot joist span limit, and our joist spans, if we go back and look at the original layout, are 16 feet, so we're good. Our spacing limit is 24 inches. Most of ours are at 16 inches or less. So as you work through all of these provisions here, you'll get a sense of whether or not you can use this document. Now, look here for a second at the floor diaphragm aspect ratio, and we're going to spend a few minutes kind of exploring the wood frame construction manual and some of the background tables to get a sense of what's going on there. But for the floor diaphragm aspect ratio, we want to try and maintain a 3-to-1 aspect ratio for floor diaphragms. Now again, here's a difference between the prescriptive provisions and the engineered provisions. If you look at the engineered section, chapter 2, you see you can go as high as a 4-to-1 floor and roof diaphragm aspect ratio. But we had to make some simplifying assumptions for the prescriptive section, and so primarily we're going to limit that to 3-to-1. So to get a sense of whether or not you're meeting those aspect ratio limits and whether your floor diaphragm actually can carry the loads that are imposed on the structure, we're going to start with table 316B of the WFCM. So just remember for a second that the length of our diaphragm, or the length of our building, is 40 feet. So the length of our diaphragm, and we're going to look at the floor diaphragm only for now. We could do the same with the roof diaphragm shown down here below, but in the interest of time, we're just going to delve into this part here, which is the floor diaphragm aspect ratio and whether the floor diaphragm has the capacity that we need. So in the wood frame construction manual, then, I'm going to navigate down here to tables 316, and that's going to take us to A1, that's the roof diaphragm, A2 is roof diaphragm, and then we get to 316B, that's the floor diaphragm, and so let's expand that a little bit so you can see it. Always check here first in the top of the table to make sure you're in the right exposure category. We're in exposure category B. And so you'll get a sense then of how we navigate the table. We're going to go to 160 mile per hour wind speed. Now our wall height is 9 feet. And so you can see over here under wall height, we've got 8 and 10, which means we're going to have to interpolate. So that's a little bit annoying, but it's not something that's too difficult that we can't handle. So jump over here to floor diaphragm width of 32 feet, which, again, you're going to have to trust me or go back and take a look at the layout, but we've got a 32-foot roof span. So we come across here and take a look, and our minimum diaphragm is 11 and maximum length is 80. Down here under 10 and 32 feet, we go over to see that our minimum is 14 and our maximum is 68. So we've interpolated that for you over here in the workbook. Back to the table, we see that the L min is 12.5 feet and the L max is 74 feet. So you say, well, that's kind of a black box. Where does that come from? So I'm going to jump now to the commentary. So don't do anything. Don't go scrambling to find another document. This one is not a free download. So if you purchased a copy of the wood frame construction manual that came with the commentary, then feel free to turn there with me. Otherwise, just listen in to what I'm talking about here so that you can get a sense of how these tables are developed. And again, those of you who are engineers in the audience, I hope you will see that this provides a really good time-saving approach for working through provisions of ASCE 7. So, table 316B is for wind loads. And what we show here in the commentary is just one example or one cell from that table 316B that we just looked at in the wood frame construction manual. So of all those values, this set of background calculations that you see here in the commentary is just one cell from that entire table. Okay, so what we assume for one of those cells, a nominal panel thickness of 15/32, 8-penny common nails at 6 inches on center around the boundaries and the supported panel edges. For this particular background calc in the commentary, it's 150 mile per hour wind speed, exposure B. We're looking at the 10-foot wall height section in that table, and we're assuming a 36-foot floor diaphragm width. So, sorry if I'm confusing you about our example problem. This is not for our example problem. This is for the commentary to the wood frame construction manual that shows all the background calculations that go into those tables. So if you're worried about it being a black box, if you want to see where those calculations come from, this commentary gives you that background. And you see down here below the figure that we're, again, want to keep that aspect ratio limit 1:3 or 3:1 for those diaphragms, both roof diaphragm and floor diaphragm. So then we take a look here at the minimum floor diaphragm length over here on the right, and we're going to first look at wind loads parallel to the ridge, because wind's obviously going to blow in both directions, parallel and perpendicular to the ridge. And so for this configuration with the parameters shown over here on the right, the floor diaphragm load is 171 pounds per linear foot. That's actually from table 2.5B of the wood frame construction manual. Don't turn there. We're going to go there in a second. Just hang with me here in this example problem so you can get a sense of how we do this. So we've got that floor diaphragm, or that diaphragm load from wind on the structure, and we calculate that through and find out that gives us a shear load of a little over 3,000 pounds. Now, that's the load. The resistance is going to come from this wind and seismic standard, 2015 wind and seismic standard table 4.2C. And we're going to use, as we are in the wood frame construction manual, it's all allowable stress design. We take a look at that table and do this on your own time, but if you go there for the case 3, which is describes how loads are relative to the panel direction, the capacity of that panel or that diaphragm is 500 pounds per linear foot. There's an adjustment to that, which actually takes it down to 232 pounds per linear foot. So then we calculate that against our load. We find out that it's about a 14-foot length required to handle that load on the building with that diaphragm capacity. We check the 3-to-1 aspect ratio, make sure we haven't exceeded that, and that's 12 feet, so we're going to take whichever one controls, whichever one's the largest is going to control, but we can't go less than 3-to-1. And so 14 feet is what's tabulated in the table for the parameters, again, that are shown here under where we define the example. So that's perpendicular to ridge. We jump to the next page. I'm sorry, that was parallel to ridge. Now we're going to jump to the next page, which shows the perpendicular to ridge wind loads. Again, the wind loads shown here come from table 2.5A. We're going to jump there in a second. We get our diaphragm capacity from the wind and seismic standard, but it's a different capacity because the load is oriented in a different direction to the way the panels are oriented. So this is a case one orientation for load with respect to panel orientation, so the capacity is going to be higher. That actually then gives us a sidewall length max of 88 feet. Our maximum building width is 80 feet, so that's where that's going to cut off. Again, we got to maintain that 3-to-1 aspect ratio, so we're going to check that. That ends up being over 100 feet, so 80 feet is what controls. And so that then gives you a sense of some of the values that are plugged into the table 316B for wind loads. That's just one of the many tables and the calculations that accompany it. Now, I told you we'd look for the loads in a second. Let's jump then. Again, you don't have to do this. Well, you can do this in the wood frame construction manual. So let's go back to the wood frame construction manual. Let's jump to chapter 2, table 2.5A. I'm going to go to 2.6 and back up. That'll get me there faster. All right, so in your wood frame construction manual, page 68, these are the loads, the lateral diaphragm loads from wind perpendicular to ridge. So those values that we just plugged into chapter 3 are all calculated up front here in chapter 2, and that's why we say that not only do we have prescriptive solutions in chapter 3, but we've actually done a lot of the hard work that's involved in ASCE 7 in calculating the wind loads. And so I'm just going to look at a real simple one from that example we were just looking at. It was 150 mile per hour case, and the floor diaphragm ended up being 250. So you go all the way down here to the bottom, the unit lateral loads down here at the bottom for the floor diaphragm are calculated down here. It shows up as 250 pounds per linear foot. You can see that for the roof diaphragm, that's going to vary depending on the pitch of the roof, but that gives you a real quick idea of the loads. And then just to dot one more I and cross one more T, I'm going to jump back into the commentary. If you don't have this commentary, don't worry about it. I just want to, again, show you the background here for where those wind loads came from. I'm going to jump to the background for table 2.5A that we just looked at, which is calculating the loads on that, the wind loads on that structure perpendicular to ridge. These are main wind force resisting system loads on that building. We from ASCE 7.10 are going to look at that minimum 10 pound per square foot wall pressure and a minimum 5 pound per square foot roof pressure as specified in ASCE 7.10. But we're also going to calculate the interior zone wind pressures, the end zone wind pressures. I'm just going to, again, to keep it simple, I'm going to jump over here to the floor, the calculation of the floor diaphragm loads. And so that really simple one that we just looked at, which was 251 pounds per linear foot, come from these calculations here of interior zone, both windward and leeward loads, end zone windward and leeward loads, which we're going to sum up here, and so you end up with a 20 pound per square foot interior zone load, a 30 pound per square foot end zone load. You run that through tributary area and find out that wind pressure is 22, almost 23 pounds per square foot for our 10-foot wall height, and then that additional 1 foot to account for the depth of the floor joist or floor diaphragm, then we come up with 250 pounds per linear foot. So I know I kind of rushed through that because we're kind of bumping up on the top of the hour here, and I want to make sure that we cover the rest of the criteria. But I did want you to see that we've got a pretty comprehensive solution in the wood frame construction manual, because we've got the prescriptive solutions in Chapter 3. Kind of looks like a black box, but it does have an engineering basis. Chapter 2, though, gives you all the loads calculated out for these low-rise structures, both wind, seismic, snow loads, all that is incorporated in Chapter 2. We got a good comment back on that last webinar that Lori did about maybe doing a little more in-depth overview of Chapter 2 at some point. And as it turns out, we had an opening come up here in the fall for one of our webinars. So I think we're going to probably delve into that a little bit more this fall and give you a good overview of Chapter 2, all the load provisions there for both wind, seismic, and snow load applications. So I'm going to jump back to the workbook. So if you're still with me, we're on page 6 of the workbook. We see that our diaphragm works. And what did we spend? 15, 20 minutes there. If you were doing the engineering calculations on that from ASCE 7 and calculating diaphragms from the wind seismic standard, I'm guessing you could spend a half an hour just on calculations. When we were able to accomplish that in about 10-15 minutes of some lookup tables in the wood frame construction manual. So again, I hope you see the time savings available there to you. The seismic table is table 316C. Again, in interest of time, I won't jump there, but we are looking at wind and seismic in this example. And so you can also look at your diaphragm to make sure that it meets the seismic load provisions as well. We talked about floor diaphragm openings a little bit earlier when we talked about diaphragm. The wood frame construction manual specifies that it's lesser of 12 feet or 50% of the diaphragm dimension, and so our largest diaphragm opening is 12 feet as seen here, and so that works. I also mentioned non-load bearing wall height and of 20 feet max. Our tallest non-load-bearing stud height in one of the gable ends is going to be 18 feet, and so that works. I just want to point out that we will be doing some tall studs for wind loads at some point. I also mentioned that load-bearing wall height limit of 10 feet for the prescriptive section, but if you look at the engineered provisions of the code, you can actually go as high as 20 feet for a load-bearing wall. And let's see, I think that's about everything I wanted to cover there for the prescriptive design limitations. So let's jump then to the next page. We're going to be talking about load paths in just a second, but I'm going to have Marcy come back and make sure you all are still awake and taking another quiz.
Okay, so the maximum dimension of a floor diaphragm opening for a WFCM structure is 12 feet, 50% of the diaphragm's dimension. The lesser of A and B, or there are no limits on floor diaphragm openings. And I'm going to make this one really fast since we are coming up on the hour. So I'm going to go ahead and close right about, I'm going to give you, there we go, right there. All right, so sharing it. So 79% said the lesser of A and B, 11% said 12 feet, 8% said 50% of the diaphragm's dimension, and then just 1% there are no limits. So, Bunny, what is the real answer?
Okay, so again in your workbook here on under the limitation section, this is spelled out in the wood frame construction manual, but it's the lesser of 12 feet or 50% of that diaphragm dimension. So good, most of you are still awake and paying attention. I'm going to just touch a little bit on load paths and the checklists, and so I'll give a heads up to the rest of the crew here that I think we're going to do the Q&A after Marcy closes us at the top of the hour. So what that means for you folks listening in is we're still going to spend about 10 minutes after the webinar is over today and do some Q&A. If you have to go and you're here for the whole hour, you'll get your credit. But if you want to, if you have some flexibility to stay an extra 10 minutes, then you can participate in the Q&A. And again, if you want to come back and listen to the Q&A at some point, if you can't stay, it's going to be recorded, so you can do it that way as well. So you've got a couple of options there. But when we talk about load path, there's a section in the wood frame construction manual that talks about, and that's section 2.1.2, a continuous load path shall be provided to transfer all lateral and vertical loads from the roof, wall, and floor system to the foundation. Similar definition in WFCM 1.3, and you see one of the figures here from the wood frame construction manual 2.2b just shows the typical uplift in shear connections that might be seen or designed for. But one of the things that we need to continue to reinforce is that loads are acting in a lot of different directions on the buildings. We've got vertical loads, both uplift and gravity loads, and so we're not just looking at gravity loads and snow and live loads, but if we're in a high wind area, we're going to get uplift on that structure as well. So bearing is not always the only thing we need to look out for. We have to tie roofs down to walls and walls down to lower walls and walls to foundations to prevent uplift. And lateral and shear loads then are occurring in different directions as well. And so what you'll see as we work through this document is that we are constantly accounting for load in three different directions. And so let me give you a good example here, because I know we're coming up on the top of the hour, but in this connections section, 2.1 talks about lateral framing and shear connections. So lateral framing of the roof, the wall, the floors, and then we're looking at uplift connections for the roof and the wall assemblies. We also want to distinguish between uplift versus overturning resistance, which can be a little confusing, especially for folks out on the West Coast, do a lot of seismic design, maybe not as much wind design. And so you talk about uplift when you're talking about hold downs. And so throughout this document in the wood frame construction manual, when we talk about hold down, loads on hold downs, we're talking about overturning resistance. When we talk about uplift connections, we're talking about wind uplift straps or wood structural panel sheathing to take care of that uplift. These lists here, this checklist that you're looking at, then allows you to make sure that you're maintaining load path. And so as you work through the wood frame construction manual and work through all the various parts of your structure. This document will allow you to check the box and see if you've actually accounted for loads in all these various directions. So again, in the appendix, there are blank versions of these checklists, and if you can want to incorporate those into your design process and you find that helpful, then we strongly encourage you to do that. Marcy, I think we ought to skip that last quiz and just close out, and then we'll have Lori come on here at the end and do some Q&A. So why don't you
absolutely
take us home.
All right. So, all right, let me get, there we go. So Woodworks is our partner organization, and they provide wood project assistance and other resources. So if you're looking for some project assistance, go ahead and contact them. Their email is help@woodworks.org, or you can visit their website. Also, there's a spot in our survey that if you'd like to be contacted by them, you can just click there and we'll put you in contact. We have a design professional membership that you can sign up for. Just go to our website again, www.awc.org/membership, if you're interested. And then also, if you are a code official, we have a special program for you if you qualify. And then there are some benefits right here listed. Again, our website, www.awc.org/codeconnections. And then just lastly, some reminders. You're going to get a follow-up email, and in there you're going to see a bunch of information. There's going to be a survey link. Remember, again, free publication possibility. You're going to get some information about a certificate of completion and continuing education credits. The actual certificates are not available immediately, so we're going to get those to you as quickly as possible, but no later than 2 weeks. And then remember that in order to receive a credits, you must be present for 90% of this 1 hour webinar. That's 54 minutes. So, and then remember the upcoming events, the continuation of this series. So next week, and then the following 2 weeks, and then next month there is our Fire Design for Code Acceptance webinar. And then our always our self-directed study program. And just keep abreast of what's going on at our education at awc.org or our website. If you're interested in booking a live presentation for a large group in your organization, contact us at education@awc.org. And I think that covers my information. I'll leave this up for a few minutes if you want to jot anything down. Otherwise, have a great day. And also, Buddy and Lori and Pete are going to be here to answer your questions.
Okay, so thanks, Marcy. Lori, if you're there and you've got a couple of questions teed up, Marcy, we may ask you to give the screen back to me here.
Oh, sure.
In a second, so if I need to refer to anything on the in the workbook or the documents I have here. So,
absolutely.
Lori, what are we at? If you're trying to talk, Lori, you might be muted.
Okay, I'm here.
Great.
I'm
going
to send it back to you, Buddy, right now, okay?
Great.
All right. So we had a lot of good questions today. Thank you, everyone, for being being so attentive. One of the first questions we had that came up was based on our limitations. So for some areas of the United States, that 70 pounds per square foot snow load is lower than, you know, than the snow load for certain regions of the country. So if you are in one of those regions where you're outside the scope of this document, what are your options?
Yeah, that's tough because the snow loads impact a lot of things. So once you go above 70, obviously you're not going to be able to size your members for gravity load. So there is a possibility of if you're in a high wind region and a high snow region, then you could design for the high wind loads Not sure what the ASCE7 load combinations are for that once you get above 70, but check to see what the requirements are for load combinations. And if it works that you can check your wind loads separate from your gravity loads, then you could do the wind load check and then come back and do your vertical loads check and see which one controls. But once you're in those higher load regions, especially in seismic country where that snow load contributes to seismic loads, it's almost impossible to use the wood frame construction manual at that point. So, good question.
Right. So that's a different webinar. You'll have to go to Spidway.
Yes.
All right. Another question we had was asking, and you touched on it briefly, it was talking about the wind speeds. So the WFCM can be used, you know, in an IRC design, but is there any time when it's inappropriate to use the WFCM for winds, or any time when you would want to use the WFCM in lieu of the IRC?
Great question. So I'm going to direct folks to, and again, if you don't have this, just follow along here on the screen, but in the Wood Frame Construction Manual commentary, and I think there's a comparable table in the IRC itself, there is a wind speed conversion table. So in the newest standards, IRC 2015, and our Wood Frame Construction Manual 2015 and IBC 2015, we're referencing ASCE 7-10 basic wind speeds. So you can see those here on at the bottom of this table on your screen here on the left, starting at 110 all the way up to 195 miles per hour. And then this conversion shows you how those map over to ASCE 705 basic wind speeds. And so I believe we checked this last time, once you get to 130 or greater in the current IRC, so above 129, that's going to kick you out of the IRC into another alternative methodology. And so that'll give you an idea of when you have to use the Wood Frame Construction Manual. But again, we tabulate everything all the way down to 110, so you could use the Wood Frame Construction Manual regardless of the wind speed. It's just that you have to use it once you get above 130 in the newer standard, and in the older codes, I believe the trigger was around 110. But check to see exactly where that triggers. I think it says greater than or equal to in one and greater than in one, so you got to make sure you're doing that exactly like the code tells you got to do it. What else?
Okay, hang on, just rolling through some of these here. We've got some flying in fast and furiously. Here's one. If we have a brick veneer, is that within the scope of the WFCM?
I think that question also came up last month, and
right.
I'm going to refer back over here to the IRC table, R307.1 in the workbook that we reproduced here. We only tabulate up to, in the Wood Frame Construction Manual, up to H over 360. So we go up and include plaster or stucco finish. Once you get to a brick veneer, there are some provisions out there that I've seen that specify H over 600. And I think it goes even higher than that, depending on where what jurisdiction you're in. I don't know that that's been specifically codified yet. So I would look at literature from the Brick Institute of America and others to see exactly what is required. But this is another one of those areas where you know, experience may just dictate what you do here. And if you've got experience with brick and you want to keep a real tight limit on that and go to H over 720 or even something higher than that, you certainly are within your right to do that as a design professional.
And also, we do have a limit on the wall assembly dead load of 18 pounds per square foot. So depending on how big your brick is, you might be above that.
Great call. Yes. Excellent point. Excellent point. Thank you.
All right. Well, we're running up on 3:10. Do you want to wrap it up on questions?
I think that's probably going to do it for today. Thanks, folks, for being here with us. And next week, same time, same place, we'll be back and look at the roof story design. And so we look forward to seeing you again next week. Have a good day.